Hi everyone. Hello. If you can hear me, can you ping on the chat that you can, or if you cannot, just let us know right now. Great, thanks. We'll just give people a couple of minutes. In the meantime, what I have done is I have pinged the link to all the details of the fellowship positions and the full-time positions open at the Mumbai studio. So please take a couple of minutes to go through that and we'll start.
Hello, God. Wake up. What a move. Hello, God. God. Yes, child. Abhi to nahi. Maybe in some time I'll see. I'm just doing for the research room, see. Where are you? Okay. Theek hai. I'll probably post dinner making it. Matlab dinner ke liye call me, 7:30 we can go and then we'll be in the studio. हाँ जस्ट वांटेड टू रीड थोड़ा ऐसे क्लास में इतना कमी वो स्पीनिंग आई जस्ट थिंक सो
ऑलराइट सो वी विल बिगिन एंड हैव पीपल कंटिन्यू टू जॉइन अस वेलकम थैंक्स फॉर मेकिंग टाइम फॉर जॉइनिंग अस ऑन दिस फेलोशिप वेबिनार फॉर डालबर्ग डिजाइन दिस वेबिनार इज specifically for the openings in the Mumbai studio. We did a webinar last week that has generic description about all studios. There will be recording of that online as well. But today we are going to focus on the Mumbai studio. Before we begin, and we'll get to know all of us soon, I wanted to share a few details of what this hour together is going to look like. So this is pretty much the third year, which is all the years that Mumbai Studio have existed. Mumbai Studio has been around for 3 years now, and this is the third time we are doing the fellowship program. Every year the fellowship program has evolved based on how we have grown as a studio and hence what the studio has needed. So the process of even doing and starting the fellowship, writing the job descriptions, and doing the outreach. Everything is done from scratch every year, given how different every year needs are. The reason I say this is because if you have not read the JDs, you will have questions that may be covered in the job description. Questions around what each role entails, questions around what are the roles and responsibilities for those particular job descriptions, what are the timelines for submissions, etc. So we are not going to focus on the details that are already there in the job descriptions, which we, all of us, take a lot of care and time to actually write down. It's not one person, the whole studio writing it. I highly recommend you go and read those JDs if you haven't already. You can read now. I have pinned the link on the chat. And so what I would highly encourage you to do hence is also, as you hear us, the questions that come in your mind, please engage in the chat, engage with everyone, not individuals, because it will be very hard to reply individually. Please engage with your questions on the chat in the channel, and mute yourself if you're not speaking. And just that, yeah, just just feel free to just interrupt us in the chat section. We will make space for questions the way it is designed is. We will give you a short overview of who we are, how we go about it, what's the work like, and then create space for questions towards the second half of this call. Right? So, anything else you would like to add? Okay, great. With that, I would quickly start with one line of introduction. So my name is Sanjukta. I'm a creative lead at the Dalberg Design Studio in Mumbai.
I'm Prerak and I'm a creative lead at Dalberg Design Mumbai.
Hi, I'm Anisa and I'm the studio manager at Dalberg Design Mumbai.
Hi everyone, I'm Sanjay and I'm a fellow at the Mumbai studio.
Great. So, you know, for all the fellowship questions, Sanjay will be around to share live experiences and the most recent experiences. And with that, over to Sanjay.
Thanks, Anisa. So, as you can see on the content slide here, we are going to talk a little bit about who are we? Who is Dalberg Design? Where can you find us? We'll talk a little bit about the value of human-centered design, which is at the core of our work. Then we'll talk about how we do our work, give you a few project examples and what do we offer. And then ultimately, we'll talk about what are some opportunities to work with Dalberg Design. And like Sanjukta said, we have space at the end for questions. So we'll just start very quickly with who is Dalberg Design and where can you find us. So Dalberg Design is a global design studio which was founded in 2014. We are a small team, but we have diverse backgrounds in multiple design disciplines. Not everyone comes from a traditional design background, but we have skill sets ranging from qualitative research to behavioral science to human rights and international development, which also is one of the reasons why Dalberg Design is so strong in terms of the talent that it brings to the board. Dalberg is also a global group that works as an integrated business across capabilities. So Dalberg Advisors purely focuses on strategy. Dalberg Research focuses on primary research and collection of quantitative data, and also monitoring and evaluation. We also have a data insights team that does a lot of data analytics. And then we have also Dalberg implementation that ensures the quality delivery of projects and products and services. So Dalberg Design is one of the many verticals of the Dalberg family. And every team is curated based on the specific needs of the project. So some projects might be purely Dalberg Advisors, some might be a mix of advisors, research, and design. We have a global footprint, like I mentioned earlier, with our design studios in London, Mumbai, Nairobi, and New York City. We're just covering a little bit about the values that Dalberg Design is based on. We treat this as our manifesto. And we thought that a good way to talk about these would be to think of anecdotes or stories that we've experienced or we've seen these values come across. So we're going to do this collectively as a team. I can speak about one of our values, which is speaking the truth from a project experience, which we did recently with the Ministry of Innovation and Technology in Ethiopia. And we were essentially mapping out what is an experience of a business owner when they're availing the service from the Ethiopian government. And as we were building this journey out, we sent it for reviews and feedback to government agencies. And what we realized was happening was that the government agencies wanted us to portray what the ideal experience should look like. And we as a team had to take a stand and say that this is representative of the business owners. That is the truth that we want our journey to represent. And so the Dalberg Design Project process is very attuned to making sure that that comes across, that the user needs come across through our process. I'm going to hand it over to my team members to add other experiences.
Go next. So I'd like to talk about the second value, which is center locally and reach locally. I think one of the, from an ops perspective, you know, we have folks who work across studios, and having a global resource pool, we have folks sometimes from one studio who can work with a colleague from another studio to actually reach a client in the third location. So that's actually one of our values. Also because we not necessarily have, you know, all the skills in one studio. We might have somebody who is a great researcher from the Mumbai studio who might work with somebody who is a behavioral scientist in another studio. And yeah, that's pretty much.
Thanks for the share. Do you want to share?
No,
go ahead. So just to look across some of the sectors that Dalberg Design focuses on, we do work across agriculture, financial inclusion, gender, strategy, water sanitation, and health and nutrition. The Mumbai studio has been doing extensive work in the fields of gender, financial inclusion, and health and nutrition, as well as many of the other sectors that you see highlighted here. So we'll take a quick look at what is human-centered design and what is the value that it brings to our process. So human-centered design is essentially an interdisciplinary methodology that we hold at the core of our work. What it essentially means is that we treat the user and their needs as the basis for our process. So we understand, we try to build a systematic understanding of what are the behaviors, aspirations, what are some of the barriers, and then design our solutions around that. So it is essentially anchored in the people rather than the product or the service. And what human-centered design considers is basically being at the intersection of three main qualities, which is desirability, viability, and feasibility. We want our service or product to be desirable for who is it being designed for. It has to be economically sustainable and at the same time feasible in terms of how is it going to be implemented, do we have the needed support or partners on board. And essentially a good solution would fit boxes across all three qualities. This is a quote by Don Norman, and it basically talks about how a good design starts with a good observation of how things are happening at the moment, and then a design process and enhances this so that the design can be best suited to user needs. So this process has been, Don Norman calls it a task analysis. That is essentially human-centered design and can be applied across the board and across disciplines. So this is a little bit about how it is exactly that we approach human-centered design. One of the core things is to meet people where they are. And so a lot of our work tends to be very field-extensive. We are often speaking to people and understanding and gathering insight into their lived experience as a very important part of building our design process. The other one is understanding the user needs holistically, because human-centered design is so geared towards the human aspect. None of these things can be looked at in isolation. So even though it might be an education-related project, we look at the user as someone who also has family planning, nutrition, or maternal and child health as something on their mind, and build a systematic and holistic understanding of their entire environment, which gives us a nuanced insight into their behavior and their aspirations. And the third one is that we co-design and iterate solutions on the go. So we like to emphasize on the fact that we design with people and not for people, which means that this is an extremely participatory process, and at every part in the design process, we make sure that our solutions are co-designed and iterated along the way. So with insight into human-centered design, I'm just going to pass this over to Seda.
All right, thank you, Sunny. The next 8 to 10 minutes we'll spend on seeing how this process manifests itself in terms of actual on-ground action and our projects. And we'll take a minute here. So what we want to emphasize is that this is a very iterative process that we follow. It's not just one stage of co-creating and testing once. It could be 4 cycles on a project. It could be one on another. So some of our projects, as you can see, might last for from planning to scaling over a year. And some of them are as short as 3 to 4 weeks. completely dependent on what we are trying to address as a problem and the scope. But one thing is assured that there is quite some multiple rounds at each of these stages. Some projects might just be up to a testing phase, some might end at measuring, some might also extend into helping our partners implement some of the work. With that, we will go to the next. This might be a well-known established fact that human-centered design borrows from different disciplines, and the practice at Dalberg thrives on multidisciplinary collaboration. So while we do practice design research and then having creative facilitation and synthesis through our process, we also borrow from behavioral science and design, having behavioral scientists as our team members. We also work regularly with people from media and from video and photography production to just be able to tell the story much better to the stakeholders. We work with quantitative design and survey firms within and outside Dalberg to back some of the solutions which are into scalability with the right amount of nationally representative data. We look from a wide ecosystem perspective, not just the end users who are going to use the system. So in this fashion, we regularly use the mixed methods approach across our projects. We'll go through a few quick case studies which were run out of the Mumbai studio. And so that gives you a good flavor and focus on India of what type of work we do. We did a work with Omidyar Network called Currency of Trust back in 2016, which when you know, this was before demonetization, so digital finance was not as big. And the context was, although there were multiple financial app solutions available, the population who sits in the rural and in the town really were not picking this up despite mobile penetration being high. So again, there's a huge gap that the providers of these services were not reaching out and were still segmenting people on basic age and where they are living. So we developed personas, which are mental models for people in terms of not like where you live and what is your age, but are you a collaborator? Are you a master user in your community? What is the risk you are taking? How open you are to try new products versus how close you are? What is your surrounding socio-cultural situation that affects these choices? Are you an influencer in your community versus not? Having built these personas on qualitative research, we also figured out how do you bring them into action, because that's the only good use. Just personas don't help. So should you first identify these master personas, or should you first be figuring out who are the collaborators and how does this translate for an action? And the outcome of this project was that our clients who were very well invested in this topic like us were able to use our end report into talking with policymakers like RBI. They were also able to utilize this to mobilize some of their own investees in digital finance to start adopting this type of learning that insights from early on. Next. We'll shift gears a bit and talk about a project which was very much hands-on and literally meant creating physical prototypes. So the context out here was one of the FMCG companies, which is a rare thing that we directly work with them, but was highly focused on figuring out how to do hand washing with soap with children. And there's enough literature that establishes that if you are able to do this, that means the hygiene and the quality of life that a child can have just shoots up extremely, extremely high, the simple act of washing hands with soap. So our problem statement was, how do you go to these schools, which are in deep rural areas in the state of Bihar, which don't have a lot of media exposure or phone exposure, and get children to wash their hands with soap? And one example, as you can see on the slide, is a quick prototype we had made of having the soap tied to the hand pump through a food mesh available in any supermarket. And after multiple iterations and being tested with almost 2,800 kids across 5 schools, there was a much more refined version of this which built itself into the program. We started from almost 40-50 ideas, which translated into 20 prototypes, iterated over 4 to 5 times in quick sprints, and ended up with a full program design with these physical artifacts. Go to the next. The last example I want to touch upon integrates behavioral nudges and builds directly on what are the habitual barriers and enablers that a service or product could utilize. We did a massive segmentation based on financial inclusion with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Based on that segmentation, which included behavioral aspects and psychographic aspects, which is very uncommon for such kind of an activity, we wanted to demonstrate that you could actually build products based on this kind of an approach, which takes into consideration what are people's saving habits. What do people consider safe and trusted in terms of an outreach? What are people's concerns around privacy? And not just look at a bottom line of an organization as to what the profit margin. And this was a product which was built for women who mostly stay at home, but want to save institutionally. And we collaborated with India Post Payment Bank and their huge network of almost 300,000 postal agents across the country, and how that could be leveraged to collect money from these women, have a sustainable business case, but building on cultural sensitivity, building on behaviors they are used to, like saving small amounts in under the temple or below the bed or hiding it from their family, and also have an artifact in the form of a literal envelope that reminded them to save everything. Yeah. With that, we'll pass on the question.
All right, so pretty much what we're here for today, what are the working opportunities? So today we're going to focus on the opportunities in the Mumbai studio. And I have, again, head over to the chat to look at the link where all the opportunities are. At the center of it, there are three key things that we look at, not just fellows, but everyone who's working at Dalberg Design. And we'll come to it in a bit as to how fellows fit into the Dalberg design team. But there are three key areas. One is that of the practitioner. So basically, your prior experience, but also experience in working in the human-centered design domain. Certain basic skills that we will come to in a bit. Collaborator, because again, not only do we collaborate with our colleagues within Mumbai studio, but also across studios in Nairobi, London, New York. But at the same time, we are highly collaborative in terms of with the other verticals that Tanvi was referring to in the beginning, which is Dalberg Advisory, Dalberg Data Insights, Dalberg Research. So that's another thing that we are looking for. And amplifier, of course, to whatever is possible in the fellowship to bring the design lens to all these collaborations, but also to the work. So in terms of the skill sets, we look at, in terms of design, we look at communication design, visual or graphic design, the whole spectrum across the design space, industrial product design, service design, media storytelling, which is the typical skill aspect of it. So like, if you remember the previous diagram, you can go to the previous one, all of that skill lies in the practitioner aspect of it, which some of it we seek through your previous experiences and see how that is relevant to some of the current work that we are about to embark on. And of course, a bunch of participatory research, behavioral sciences, if you have a background in ethnography, anthropology, journalism, etc. Some of the specialty that we have, of course, that we touched upon earlier on is global health, education, employment, justice, equity, and mobility, agriculture, financial inclusion. So if you have experience in working in any of these spaces, that's a great bonus, because those are also some of the high focus areas within Dalberg Design. And for the 2020 fellowship, the applications are open in the Mumbai studio. When you head over to the website that's there in the chat, you will see all the job openings. Once again, like we spoke in the beginning, each job description is very, very carefully crafted by the whole team. So I will highly encourage you to go through that in detail when it comes to who we are seeking, what kind of experience we are seeking, what the kind of opportunity we'll get to work in, what are the deadlines. Everything is mentioned in there. You will also see some full-time positions for the Mumbai studio, which is the visual designer. So both fellowships and visual designer full-time positions, fellowships are minimum 3 months, are open on the website. So please head over there and read through in detail. All right. So in the beginning of this engagement, you actually signed up through a Google form where we also asked you to submit your questions in advance. So what we will do is we are going to prioritize some of the questions that came out as common in the Google form, and hopefully that will also answer some of the questions that you all have right now. But as you will see, we are starting to also respond in the chat, so you guys can continue looking at the chat and respond to people if you haven't covered any, and make the rest 30 minutes of time as a space for your questions. Anything you would like to add? Great. So one of the common questions that we always get is, can I apply for more than one position? And there is no answer from our side, because the question back to you would be, are you eligible for all the positions that you're applying for? Usually, at this stage, each fellowship position is pretty unique in its own right. And it's a very rare case that someone would actually be equally relevant to all these positions. So I would ask you to reflect after reading all the positions to see where you fit in the most. We of course do not discourage you from applying for more than one, but if we realize that you have applied to all the positions blindly, that definitely does not go in support of the candidate, because it seems like you haven't put in much thought into it. I would encourage you to read and then apply accordingly. Whatever position, one or more than that, is applicable to you. The next question is, does Dalberg Design sponsor visa? So Dalberg Design does not sponsor visa. We are definitely not looking at sponsoring for visas for the fellowship position. But if, for example, there is a fellow who is highly promising during the fellowship program, they have come on their own expense for the visa, and it converts into a full-time position within Dalberg Design, then there are conversations of how to kind of go about sponsoring that visa for a full-time position. Anything you would like to ask about?
No, it was quick.
The third most common question is there a stipend? So yes, there is a stipend. There have been other questions around how much it is. So at the base, what we can say is the average stipend for a fellow definitely covers for a living conditions in Mumbai, so you would be able to kind of rent out a place and stay within reasonable limits, of course. Beyond that, it's always a conversation between Dalberg Design and the fellow, depending on what experience they are bringing and how relevant they are to the role and what future prospects we see, is a conversation between the fellow and Dalberg Design. The other question I heard was, can it be taken for a short-term duration? So just for your information, the minimum duration of the fellowship is 3 months. And we have kind of arrived at those 3 months after a lot of iterations by applying the SPD principle on ourselves. What we realize is there is a certain sweet spot of time where the fellow is able to engage at enough depth for both project work, internal studio work, team building, etc., and have a certain experience. And that also works for Dalberg Design in order to have a meaningful engagement and have the fellow be able to actually contribute meaningfully to project work. So no, it cannot be taken for a shorter duration. What exactly does the fellowship entail, and in what field will I acquire experience in? So for the first part, please go and read the job descriptions. In what field you will acquire experience? At the base of it, all experiences can be clubbed under the human-centered design umbrella. But again, depending on the project, what sector it is, you may be exposed to a new sector different from what you're experienced in, or you may be able to contribute more because you are in a familiar sector, whether that's health or financial inclusion or gender and technology, it will depend. But any other thoughts there? Okay. Do you accept interested candidates who do not have prior design experience? So we do have a position of business design where we are not necessarily looking at people with a pure SED experience. So please go over and read the description of the business design fellow. For the other two, Talent for Impact and Visual Design Fellow, we do expect people to come with an understanding of the human-centered design process, but preferably having also worked and implemented the process in real-life work experience. How many years of experience do fellows typically have? Do fellows often go to work for a Dalberg in a permanent capacity after this fellowship? Fellows, minimum we say 2 years? Yeah, we have a minimum expectation for people who are applying to have 2 years of work experience in the human-centered design space if you're applying for Talent for Impact and Visual Design Fellowship. So the upward has been very varying. We have also had people like Stephen who came in with 8 or so years of experience, came on as a fellow, added such great flavor and such great expertise that he did not have in the studio. We have had a PhD candidate, Sana, who came in after a PhD as a behavioral scientist fellow, brought a whole different toolkit to Dalberg design that we didn't have. So the experience upward of 2 years definitely varies. And the fellows often go on to work for Dalberg in a permanent capacity. Again, it depends if the studio has the necessity for a full-time position for that fellowship, both the duration, then yes. We have in Mumbai built most of our studios for fellowship programs, so people have definitely come and become full-time hires. It is always a mutual decision, it's never one-sided. So those 3 months should give enough insight to the fellow, to Dalberg design, as to how do you fit in, do you like the work culture, do you like team members, do you see yourself working with them, spending considerable amount of time with them. Does the work excite you? Does your prospect of growth excite you? So it's a mutual conversation. There have been people who have gone on to leave Dalberg design after the fellowship to do other things, to go back to their studies or to become a contractor because they did not want to be full-time, or a lot of them have also become full-time people. How many projects does a fellow work on at a given time? It varies. It varies from being fully staffed on one project to sometimes being 50% and maximum 2 projects, but not more than that. But mostly it's 1 project at a time. If you talk about 3 months, it varies again because sometimes you may be staffed the moment you come on board and you may get to do back-to-back projects. Sometimes you get to do a project, but then also work on internal initiatives. I'm curious if you want to share a little bit of your experience on project work.
Yeah, so I, echoing what Sandhya said, I think primarily it's one project that you start from, but there's also a lot of internal initiatives, like building internal training guides or stuff that you can work on while you're on the project. For example, being within developing a general 101 toolkit for synthesis and how synthesis works in Dalberg design. So while you may be on a project, there are many other things that you can devote your time on internally.
Great. One question, I'm looking at the chats and also some of the questions that have come here. The difference between the experience of a fellow and an employee, fellowships or internships tend to be treated as, you know, a watered-down version of what the real experience would be. Our approach at Dalberg Design is to not do that. A fellow, because they're coming with experience, they're not fresh out of college, and they bring certain experience from either a particular sector or a particular toolkit, like behavioral sciences, or health, or just implementing human-centered design in a grassroots organization, for example. They are treated, they're expected, and they are supposed to work as an employee. So at no point is the responsibility of a fellow any less than an employee. Also because by design, we are a very small and lean team. So fellows come on a project as a team member and are not assigned any less responsibilities because they're fellows. So that covers the next question. Is any travel involved during the fellowship program? Yes, if you're on a project. Our work is very travel based because we do research and we go on location. So short answer, yes. Do we get exposure of field while designing the concepts? Yes. Do we have mentors or we assist designers in groups or as an individual? Short answer, yes. You always have mentors in the form of your colleagues who are working, who may have been at Dalberg Design longer. So purely by that virtue, they become your go-to people for any form of advice on bowling, getting used to. There is nothing like assisting because everyone has very defined work streams that they're supposed to execute. But yeah, in a project layout, you will have a project manager, a certain senior team member, and then fellows or junior designers who will have their own work streams carved out and will be answerable and accountable to other team members. At the same time, other team members will also be accountable to you. So that answers your question. So those are all the questions that we got through submission. So thank you, one, for sharing those questions online. But curious if there are other questions on the chat that we should be answering. Let's focus on questions on fellowship.
There was one question about what is the difference in the kind of work that a Dalberg designs and a Dalberg advisor team member would perform if they were both part of the team.
That's a good question. Curious if anyone wants to take that up.
Thanks, I can take that up. So first of all, most of our projects out of the Mumbai studio are a collaboration between the advisory, strategic advisory and the design team, and that's one of the key reasons we sit out of here. The typical differences, now these vary from project to project, and a lot of work has been going on integrating of when a strategic advisory team is there and a design team is there, how do we best work together? So first of all, everyone is treated as the same team. It's not looked at as these are from two different businesses, etc. For that project, you work like a single unit. Obviously, advisory folks bring their own niche from their consulting toolkit. For example, their approach to problem solving in terms of building hypothesis tree, in terms of going deep into literature review, when the time for business case comes, or when there is a pilot implementation or a monitoring and evaluation network that comes through, they contribute much heavier. And in terms of when, for example, we are prepping to do human-centered design research, when we are trying to figure out what's the systemic lens to take to the problem, building the research toolkit, conducting the research, synthesizing, so on and so forth, the design team member plays a heavier role. Having said this, both the advisory and design team members play a role in each of these fields that I talked about, just the degree of that varies. And over a period, we have strongly noticed that there are folks who shine through as what we call as hybrid, for lack of a better term, who have a strong foothold in, say, for example, design, but could also do some of the skill sets of advisory and vice versa.
Great. There is a question that was sent to me privately. Quick request, when you type in your questions, please type to everyone. That way we all will be able to see it and not miss out on your questions. Privately does not always work and you may miss out on your questions. The question is, I'm keen on the business design fellowship, but I'm also interested in design research. Will we get to interact and engage with those project team members too? And is starting date flexible for June starting? So starting date is flexible depending on how promising there is a mutual understanding of the fit. So if you feel that you fit into that position and that's the mutual feeling with Dalberg Design as well, then we can talk about the start dates. The start dates are also given in the descriptions based on how we see what we need more immediately and what can be delayed. It's always a mutual conversation on starting dates. So yes. Will you get to interact with people on design research? I would say absolutely yes, you will, because I don't think this design will happen in isolation of the project work that we are doing. Will you get to execute design research with the team? That will again be something that we can have a conversation about, depending on how we prioritize the needs. So if there are very high need scenarios where we need you to be in the studio and actually work with the relevant team members on business design aspect, then how do we manage that for you to be brought onto the field? But we would expect anyone who comes on board as a business design fellow to have the taste end to end, from the inception of the project, submitting a proposal, to actually starting kicking off the project with clients, doing field research, coming back, translating research insights into, you know, the project direction, etc. So we would definitely expect them to have an end-to-end phase of it. So short answer is yes. It will have to be just figure out how. Another question privately was, audio is breaking. So the question is around sponsoring visa and accommodation. So I'll just quickly repeat. We do not sponsor visa for fellows unless the fellowship, at the end of it, there is a possibility of it becoming a full-time position. It's only then when we look at work visas for a full-time position. We do give a stipend to fellows if they are affording their own visa, and the stipend will at least cover your staying and basic expenses. Now, the stipend also varies depending on who the role is for and how much experience they bring and what values they're adding to the role.
I can take the next one. It says, will fellows be exposed to all aspects of the design process? Typically, how many iterations are tested with users? Do projects allow for co-creation with users? Fellows are for all purposes, but they are fellows treated like a full-time employee with a little more bandwidth to try some things and fail and learn. But again, based on the experience, they are allocated appropriate project responsibilities on live projects which are running out there. Which means, yes, you will be able to go through design projects in its entirety. How many iterations are tested is heavily, heavily contextual and project dependent. For example, the current project I'm on is a year-long engagement, which has got at least 4 rounds of testing, a 6-month pilot, and then refinement, versus a project which we did end of last year, which had got just 1 round, given it was a 2.5-week project.
All right, so I had another private chat question. For the business design fellow position, is there flexibility in the format for the portfolio for people who do not have graphic design experience?
I can put it simply, this is great. The business design lead at the Mumbai Institute. For the business design fellowship, there isn't a requirement on submission of the portfolio. You just need to submit your cover letter and resume. And if you want to submit anything else, please do so. But it isn't the.
Okay, thank you. So another question was around
what kind of portfolio are we expecting to do with this design fellowship?
Like I said, as for the business design fellowship, we are not expecting any kind of portfolio. As you would see in the job description, the kind of work that you'll be exposed to is slightly different from a designer, and you will work very closely with the team here to look at what are the different kinds of business opportunities within the design thinking space that we can leverage that are outside of the traditional advisory model. Which may or may not require, which traditionally would not require a full-fledged portfolio or deep expertise. Obviously, if you have the expertise with this, it's definitely a plus. So we do not need a portfolio for business design collection. If you do have one, if you have design techniques or expertise from previous work, please feel free to share that, but we do not need a portfolio for business design collection.
There's one around the application process itself and about how does the hiring process work once the application is submitted.
Yeah, I'm sure if I can take that. It's typically like any other hiring process. you will submit your application, and of course it will go through a round of screening. Once that happens, you should typically hear from us on the status of your application, that is when you're moving to the next round for an interview. If you don't move to the next round for an interview, we will let you know. Around the timeline for a response from our end, I think it should take us about 4 weeks to get you a response. You know, there are a lot of applications coming in, and currently the team itself does the screening, and they are doing that simultaneously along with their projects and field work and travel and things like that. So do expect us to get back to you within about 3 to 4 weeks. What happens after the screening, we do invite folks who have made it through the first round of screening for an interview. There are a couple of rounds, I would say, about 4 rounds of interviews, after which we make an offer. And of course, during those 4 rounds of interviews, we'll talk about the work that you've done in the past, maybe case studies, and you have opportunities on all these interviews to ask us questions as well.
All right, we'll take a couple of minutes to see if you have any further questions.
Yeah, and so then maybe we'll share a little bit more for the next few minutes if people have more questions. Yeah. So, one kind of a theme based on type of questions were being asked was also getting down to, will we be able to do co-creation with folks or not in a project, or what is the degree of participatory when we do this kind of work and game, given its consulting environment as well. So again, this I can take one or two project examples. So we have any other questions? Taking the example of the current project that some of us are working on, it's about engaging men in family planning and nutrition, and what could be interventions that could allow us to do this well. Now, the end result of something like this would be a program which is implemented. Now, this program might have a product in the form of a financial service that allows you to save for family planning or nutrition. It could have an awareness campaign that leverages the existing mobile phones that people have. It could be something which is completely on ground implemented, like counseling sessions through self-help groups that exist, or the ASHA / Anganwadi healthcare workers network. And it would mean that we would need to go and meet these people, talk to them, first understand their challenges, their aspirations, etc., even before we get to co-creation. And the next few stages would involve co-designing things with not just our end users, but with experts in the field. I mean, people have been doing this work for years. So co-creation would be much wider topic for us, ranging from in using the expertise that Dalberg has, our design folks have, along with other experts, along with our end users, along with other folks in the system like the healthcare workers or so on so forth, other institutions. So it is a much wider gamut that we adopt.
Great. So we don't have any more questions. In which case, we would love to give back the 10 more minutes of time of your evening from this call. Thanks. Oh, we have one more question. Does the scale vary for each project? I guess, Fatima, you're still writing the second half of your question. But yes, short answer, yes. We have had projects that last for 2 weeks to now on a project that's going to be running for a year. It depends on a lot of things. One, where the client is in their journey, hence what do they need, and where can Dalberg Design add value, and hence what's the budget. A lot of things come together to define the scope of a project. We do want to work across a wide variety of clients, including governments, foundations, social enterprises, NGOs, startups, and hence the scale of the project varies very, very widely. To give two quick examples, we have done a 2-week sprint for a startup launching a financial loan product, entering the Indian market after seeing success in Pakistan, South Africa, East Africa, and right now working on how do we engage men in sexual reproductive health and nutrition in Bihar. That is going to be a 1-year long project. So yeah, it varies. Priya has a question. I love how questions are coming in the last moment. Thanks, guys. The range of stipends for fellowships. Again, the stipend varies. At the base, it covers your living expenses. Beyond that, it's a conversation based on that role, your experience, what you're bringing. So it's again a conversation from fellow to fellow. But at the base of trip, it definitely covers your living, staying, and other expenses in the city. I guess from a. Do you want to take it?
Sure. So there is one on how do you validate the success for a project. Now, success of a project is determined on different angles. Were we able to meet the objectives we set out with our stakeholders, partners/clients, which could mean that if we were going to develop a new program, or if we were going to help them test something that exists, or if we were going to come up with 10 new insights, what that meant or not. Okay. Were we able to do it within time? Was our team actually happy to go through this experience? Is this going to see, implementation less, which depends on different projects. Sometimes it's about a policy in privacy, which would take 2 to 3 years to see into effect. So success is very subjective in those terms and is multifaceted for us to see in that fashion.
Okay, we have another question. For the business design position, what ratio of job responsibilities will be internal, capacity building, business learning versus external? I would highly recommend you to go read the job description. I obviously have a short version of the answer to that.
I would say it will. So all the work that we do will primarily be external things, right? Even if it's about, say, business development and new code, new venture ideas, new proposals and so on. Although all the work you can call it internal, but eventually will be showcased to potential clients, potential sort of accelerators, investors, other types of clients. So I would say everything that we do is external facing. It is not external, won't be external facing in the sense that clients on say projects may not see their work, but it will still be external facing because the audience is outside of the Dalberg design of the studio.
Just waiting to see if there are any final questions on the chat right now, since we have a couple of minutes. If not, I think we can close the webinar now. Feel free to go through the details again for each of the positions. Also, if something still remains unclear, you can connect with us through the Dalberg Design Connect link. I hope you enjoyed the webinar and found it extremely informative. I'm just going to see if anybody else would like to add.
Yeah, we will share a recording of this webinar on the website. So if you have missed the part of it, or people you know or you think will find it relevant as well, and if you want to share, you can go to our website and find a link to this webinar in another couple of days. Great. Thank you for joining today. Hoping to see more applications for the Mumbai studio. And please engage on the website. All the details, deadlines, everything is out there. Thanks for joining today.
Thank you.
Thank you.